ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति 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 ॐ समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम् ॐ सच्चिदानन्दरूपाय विश्वोत्पत्यादिहेतवे तापत्रयविनाशाय श्रीकृष्णाय वयं नमः. सो दिस श्लोक इज व्हाट वी वेर टू चैंट. नारायणं पद्मभुवं वशिष्ठं शक्तिं च तत्पुत्रं पराशरं च व्यासं शुकं गौडपदं महा गौडपादं महांतं गोविंद योगींद्रमथास्य शिष्यं श्रीशंकराचार्यमथास्य पद्मपादं. श्रीशंकराचार्यमथास्य पद्मपादं च हस्तामलकं च शिष्यं तं तोटकं वार्तिककारमन्यान् अस्मद्गुरून् सन्ततमानतोऽस्मि. सो हरि ओम् एंड सल्यूटेशन्स् टु आल्. वी आर् इन् द 10th डिस्कोर्स् आफ् चाप्टर् 2. वी सा द 10 कैरेक्टरिस्टिक् फीचर्स् आफ् श्रीमद्भागवतम् एज अ महापुराण. Purana has only 5, this Mahapurana has 10. And each of those were elaborated a bit, what is the meaning of each of those, Sarga, Visarga, Sthanam, Pushanam, Poshanam, Utayaha, Manvantara, Ishanukatha, Nirodha, Mukti and Ashraya. And it was said that Ashraya is the main one. All the 9 are for Ashraya, so that we seek refuge of the Lord. Then it was said after that this Ashraya is independent. Everything else depends on this. So this whole world has these 3 aspects, Adhyatma, Adhibhuta and Adhidaiva. One cannot be without the other 2. And all are known by the Supreme Lord, who is the Ashraya, and he has no other Ashraya. So these 3 depend on the Lord, but the Lord doesn't depend on them, nor does he have any other source of Ashraya. So that's where we had stopped at verse 9. Now, again the Srishti Kram happens. So this cosmic being, Purushaha, emerged from this egg-shaped universe and he stood apart, looking out for a foothold for himself, and created this holy waters. So these holy waters which proceed from Nara. Nara here is not a human being. Nara here is the cosmic being. So the sacred waters which were created by this cosmic being are called as Nara. So Mahavishnu is that cosmic being, as though who created Nara, sacred waters. And in these sacred waters, one who resides, Ayana, is to stay, abode. Ayana means abode. So this sacred abode is of Narayana, Narasya. Naraha Ayanam Yasya Saha Narayana. The sacred waters are the divine abode of whose, that is Narayana. So Narayana is the utpatti of the word Narayana is that. And then it says that cosmic being only is Narayana. He is only the Nara water, and he is only the Narayana, and he is only the Nara also. So having assumed the form of Narayana, he rested on that water for 1,000 years. And that's why he's called as Narayana. Now, the 12th verse says that Dravyam karma cha kalascha svabhavo jiva eva cha yad anugrahata santi na santi yad upekshaya. These five factors, they exist by the grace of the Supreme Being. And if the Supreme Being is indifferent, they will not exist, they will not function. What are these? So one is the Dravya, the material, gross elements. Karma, so the whole karma siddhant we know. See, Dravya also is mentioned here because we think that nature is independent and five elements create the world by themselves. But the Bhagavatam here, he says, they will not function without the grace of Bhagavan. So one is the Dravya, second is karma. Bhagavan is a karma adhyaksha, karma faladata. The capability to act comes from the Lord. The laws that govern the action, karma, siddhant, that is created by the Lord. And the results are given according to the Lord's, according to the laws. The karma phala adhyaksha, karma phala data is also Bhagavan. And hence the capability in us, because of which we are able to act, the laws, the results, all that is because of the presence of the Lord. Hence, Dravyam, Karma, Kala, past, present and future, they also created because of the Lord. How? Only when the projection starts, time comes into being. It is like us. When we wake up, then for us time exists. When we are in deep sleep, there is no time. Same thing we apply to the cosmic being. So Kala also is there because cosmic being is there. Otherwise there is no Kala. So Dravyam karma cha kalascha. Then Swabhava. Each individual being's nature, based on the three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas, the characteristics. And the jiva, the beings themselves. All of them, yad anugrahata santi. They all exist only by the grace of Bhagavan. Now, these five factors, ordinarily in our daily life, we think none of these require Bhagavan. Elements are functioning on their own. Law of karma is a law. Maybe it is there. Many people don't even believe in law of karma. But if somebody believes in law of karma also, they say it exists on its own. Cause and effect, that is science, not logic. Why is God required for it? So Dravya is also without God, logic is also without God. You know, Kala is just passing time. Why are you bringing God into picture? Past, present, future. Past become, I mean the future become present, which becomes the past. It's a flow of time. Why God is required in this? Swabhava, it is my Swabhava. I am what I am. And jiva. Jiva is born out of biological process. Why bring God into it? Now all this is a so-called rationalist argument. But the point is forgotten that all these by themselves are jada vastu. They cannot exist. Karma is, law of karma is jada. Law cannot come into being on its own. Dravya, matter is also jada. Kala. Kala makes sense only for a sentient entity. From where did that sentience come in us, the jiva? Even if I say I am the jiva and time exists, only when I am there, aham is there, that I is the consciousness factor. And same way, Swabhava. How did this nature come to you? No, that came because of my karma. How did you do karma? Oh, that I have been doing for many lives. None of these five will exist without Bhagavan. That's why he says, na santi yad upekshaya. If the Lord becomes indifferent to these, they will not even exist. Forget them functioning. So this is a standpoint of spirituality. Vedanta also says the same thing. Without the presence of consciousness, nothing will function. Here it is in the name of cosmic being. Both are same. So now, all these are existing by His grace, and this Supreme Lord, who was one, desired to become many, same analogy, I mean same description which we find in the Upanishads, you find here in Bhagavatam. So in that sense, Bhagavatam it also is Upanishad. Because same thing, Ekoham Bahusyama, Upanishad will say. Here it is also saying the same thing, Eko Nanatvam Anvichan, Yoga Talpat Samuthitaha. So from these divine waters he rose and with invoking his power of Maya, created. Mayaya Vyasrajat Tridha. Now he created the three. What is the Tridha? Three. Adhidaiva, Adhibhuta, Adhyatma. Now what was said earlier, that these three cannot be different from each other. That is what is now elaborated as the whole creation. So this entire creation is a combination of these three. Adhidaiva, Adhibhuta and Adhyatma, and one cannot be without the other. So Adhidaivam, Athadhyatmam, Adhibhutam iti Prabhu. Yathaikam Paurusham Viryam Tridha Vidyat Tachrunu. Vidyata Tachrunu. So now how this one cosmic being invoking his energy, power, Maya, came to be divided into three parts. Now that you listen. Now comes the creation of this, you know, the gross and the subtle creation. So I'm going to take two examples. Rest of it is same. All the senses, etc., follow the same thing. So quickly we will do this portion. So what happens? Now, when the cosmic being bestirred himself, there arose from the space within his body the acuteness of the senses, the strength of will, and the strength of body as well. Three things. Ojaha saho balam jagne tata prano mahanasubhu. And from these, the prana came. Remember, this is the cosmic being's body. Now, just as the attendants follow the king, that example is given here. The senses in all the living beings are active when this prana is active. The cosmic prana is the prana which is there in each one of us. And that's why the prana shakti, see, that's why the prana is called the kriya shakti. The prana is not defined in our spiritual literature as air. Shvasa or vayu is not prana. Prana is the kriya shakti. The kriya shakti because of which any kriya is happening, including this eyelids movement, eyebrows movement, not just the five physiological systems. They are one aspect, prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. But all the other movements of the body are happening only because of prana shakti. And that's why when the prana ejects out of the body, along with this subtle body, prana goes. Then that gross body cannot make any movement because neither the will is there nor the prana is there. Only the gross body is there. The will is there in the mind and intellect. And prana is the dynamic power of movement. Both are gone now from that body. So that body will not move. So prana shakti, that's why is the cosmic energy of the Lord in us. Ojas it is called. That's why the word uses ojaha saho balam jagnyo tata prano mahanasuhu. So this ojas and the food that we eat, the air that we breathe, the water we drink, the sunlight exposure we have, the fasting, etc. that we do, that will nourish and strengthen this ojas, and it is used as a fuel for everything that we do. So every single act at the body level, as well as thinking, because brain is used for thinking. Mind uses the brain. How? Prana shakti is required. So thinking also will destroy prana. The more negative I think, more my prana shakti gets destroyed. So this vital energy in us is kriya shakti, is a divine energy, ojas, and that ojas is transformed into tejas when we live in self-control, brahmacharya and ahimsa, satyam, and we do dhyan, then this swadhyay, dhyan, bhakti, bhajan, all these spiritual practices will transform this ojas into tejas. The tejas is a spiritual glow. So the reason why here I'm saying all this is because we think of prana only as some five physiological systems. Because that's what we have learned also. But it is more than that. You know, there are five upapranas also. Dhananjaya, Kurma, Krikala, Naga, one more is there, I forget. They are the upapranas who are responsible for sneezing, yawning, you know, like that. Each one has one job, hunger, thirst, each of these. So five pranas plus five upapranas, and they govern all the activities of this body. And that's why he says here that like the attendants follow a king, so the senses in all the living beings are active when this prana is active, but cease to be active the moment the prana becomes inactive. Now, he says that when the prana became active in the cosmic being, then the hunger, the cosmic being felt hunger and thirst. Now, the moment he felt hunger and thirst, what happened? See, when the moment he felt inclined to eat and drink, a mouth appeared in him in the first instance. From the mouth came out the palate in which the sense of taste was produced, and thence were evolved the different kinds of taste which are experienced by the sense of taste. Okay, so now this is the, now these three factors are involved in this: Adhidaiva, Adhibhuta, Adhyatma. So the tongue is the adhibhuta. The sense of taste is adhyatma. The deity presiding this taste is Varuna Devata, is adhidaiva. So these are the three. And of course that goes then further, that the object for eating enjoyment also will get created. That is part of adhibhuta. So objects and the tongue, adhibhuta, the sense capability to enjoy, adhyatma, and then Varuna, who is the presiding deity of taste, is the adhidaiva. So now in this way, what is important in this point to understand is all this got created by the will. Just by the will. Cosmic being felt hungry, then all this came out. Same way, one more example, if you see, the cosmic being felt inclined to speak. There emanated from his mouth the god of fire, the organ of speech itself, and the act of speaking, which depends both on the organ of speech and the deity presiding over the same. Till then, the cosmic being remained under water, controlling his breath for a pretty long time. If somebody has that question, how was he there till then? Controlling the breath, he was in the water. Then came out. Then all this happened. The fire and all this. So, in the same way now, for the ears. So, Karna, and then Shrotra Indriya, then the Digdevata, and then the sound and the space. Same way for the touch. So the skin, the capability to touch, and Vayu is the presiding deity, and the air and the objects which one can touch and feel. Then the eyes, the capability to see, and then the Surya Devata, and then the fire and various forms. Tongue we already saw, smell we already saw. These are five senses of knowledge. Then same way, five senses of action. So actually what we saw was the speech. Na? Speech is actually the symbol of action. and smell we saw. Taste and speech is what we saw. So the tongue part we saw first. So speech, the capability to speak, then the tongue, and then the Agni Devta. For speech it is Agni and for taste it is Varuna. That we should not confuse. Two different deities for two different sense capabilities. One is sense of knowledge, which is taste. Other is a sense of action, which is speech. And so then the speech, words, language, all that. Then comes the experience of sensation. So this hair, and then Mahiruha is the deity for the hair, and then the touch sensation and the itching and other things, they are created. Then hands, the capability to grasp and the strength to do things with the hands. Indra is the deity of that. And then the activities which one can do with the hands. Same way with the legs, the capability to move around. And Vishnu is the in our Tattva Bodh, we learn as Vishnu. But here he's called Upendra. Because there also Vishnu, in Tattva Bodh, when they say Vishnu, it is not this cosmic being or the supreme Mahavishnu. It is one demigod. Here they have given as Upendra. Then the genital organs and the capability to reproduce. Then Prajapati is the presiding deity, and then the act of procreation. Then to expel waste. So the organ of evacuation, then Payuhu is the organ of evacuation, the capability to evacuate, then Mrityu, Yama. So here we see that Mrityu, Apayoha Mrityu, that we see in Tattva Bodh also. Here the one more is added is Mitra. The Mitra is not Surya Devta. Mitra is one demigod. Then the evacuation. And then the capability to change the body is Nabhi. So the navel is created. Apana and Pranavayu are the they will eject out of the body. And Mrityu. So Mrityu has two portfolios in that sense. And then actual death. Here they have given in Bhagavatam a little more elaboration of the senses of action. So consuming food, so the abdomen is created, and then the capability of that abdomen, then Samudra is the deity of that abdomen, and then satisfaction from all the filled stomach when we eat. And then to drink also. Again, same it is. Kukshihi is the abdomen, and then the Nadyaha, the veins which drink in the intestine, and then Nadyaha, the river. The rivers are the presiding deity for the drink that we consume, and the object is nourishment of all the rasa that we take. And last comes the Hridaya, the mind. So to contemplate on the Supreme Lord, on his own Maya in this context. For cosmic being it is his own Maya, for us it is Supreme Lord. The Hridaya is created. The capability in that Hridaya is all the feeling and experiencing, contemplating, thinking, all that. Chandra is the Devata of that. And then the determination, desire are the various things that this mind will go through. So now all this is created, and please remember this entire thing is a part of what we know as the first of the 10 characteristics, that is Sarga. So this verse number 10 to 35 is Sarga. The whole thing is called Sarga. All this what I just spoke is all there in the shlokas here. Now, what is said in this 31, you see. From the element of earth, water and fire, seven constituents of the body are made. So what are the seven constituents of the body? These are the seven constituents. Tvak, charma, mamsa, rudhira, medaha, then majja, asthi. These are seven. Dhatavaha means these are seven dhatus. When we say in the Nirvana Shatkam, Nava Sapta Dhatur Nava Pancha Kosha. That Sapta Dhatur is this. Seven aspects which make the body. Meaning they are Jada by themselves again. Then the Prana, Sapta Prana come from where? So he says they come from the space, water and air. See, this is again the cosmic body of the Supreme Lord and the same Amsha we all are. So the cosmic air came from, cosmic prana came from the air, water, sorry, ether, water and air together. Yeah. So this is the creation of seven dhatus and seven pranas. You may say how seven pranas came. So one, the five main pranas, and maybe they have included two other upapranas in that. Or it may be infusing life and ejecting of life. Or seven, that is also possible. So then, having said that, now what will be the next part of the creation? All the equipments are made. The sense faculties are there. Objects are there. The cosmic ego is not yet created. So now the next is that. Gunatmakani indriyani bhutadi prabhava gunaha manas sarva vikaratma buddhir vijnana rupini. So now this is the, who is going to use all this? So then that is created. The senses of perception are all directed towards their objects, and the objects of senses are born of the ego. Mind is the source of all morbid feelings, while intellect reveals to us the reality of all objects. So this now becomes the gross form of Bhagavan, the cosmic being. Etad bhagavato rupam sthulam te vyahritam maya mahyadibhis chavaranaihi ashtabhir bahiravritam. This is called the eightfold sheets. The gross form of the Lord is enveloped outside by the eight sheets. Earth, water, fire, air, ether, ego is the samashti ahankara. Don't forget that. Which means Hiranyagarbha or Mahatattva. So ego, the Mahatattva and the Prakriti. Eight. Here they have separated this ego and this Mahatattva. But otherwise they should be actually one and the same. Cosmic ego, Samashti Ahankar or the Hiranyagarbha or this Mahatattva, they mean one and the same thing actually. Beyond this is the Avyakta. What we learn in Vedanta, Brahman plus Maya becomes Ishvara, which is Avyakta, and then comes Hiranyagarbha, and then becomes the Virat. Here it is going from Virat to Hiranyagarbha to Ishvara. The process is going like that. Now beyond this is the Lord's most subtle form, which is unmanifest, unqualified, having no beginning, middle or end, eternal and outside the realm of mind and speech. So this is the gross and the subtle form. Now what he says is, very important is this shloka now, 35. See, Amuni bhagavadrupe mayate anuvarnite ubhe apina grinhanti maya srishte vipaschitaha. Now what he says here, I have described to you the gross and the subtle form of the Lord who has created all this. It is the power of Maya that Bhagwan invoked and created all this. So the wise people, Vipaschitaha, Ube Apina Grindanti, they don't accept both these, neither gross nor subtle. Why? Maya Srishti. Because they are created by Maya. Achha, so then what do the wise people do? Contemplate on Supreme Reality, which is Narayana, as all pervasive, formless, absolute truth, Satchidananda Swarup, whose power is Maya. Now, if somebody can't contemplate on that, then the rest of the things are done. So very clear they are now in Bhagavatam also. There are some people, if they say that, oh, we are only, the Bhagavatam is only doing Krishna worship and is all, entertaining emotionalism and all that they are ignorant. They have not understood what is written in the Bhagavatam. Very clearly he says the wise people refuse to accept for their upasana the gross and the subtle form. Which means what level is only remember absolute Brahman and Nirguna Nirakar Tattva, I am one with that. Jnana Marg complete. Jnana meaning they become Jnani, not Jnana Marg. They become one with that. Or if you say no, they are still on the path, then they are worshipping only the absolute Sat Chit Anand. They are not, forget Ishta Devata's form, they are not accepting cosmic form only. Which means they have rejected duality completely, no? If cosmic form is not accepted, then the creation cannot be accepted. Ishwar also cannot be accepted. Why? Maya Srishta. That's why Maya Srishti. It is all both this gross and subtle form. Not accepted. Subtle form is this Hiranyagarbha and Ishwara. Gross is the Virat, the cosmic form. All three not accepted. Then what will you accept? Brahman only. This is the most beautiful line. So if we want to realize the absolute truth, what we should do? Focus on that Brahman. If we can't focus, then yes, take the support without losing faith. We should not have this thinking that, oh God, I'm not eligible for that. So chalo, I have to settle with this gross form. What to do now? Not like that. It is also Bhagwan only. But what we call is Bhagwan expressing along with the Maya. That is Bhagwan without Upadhi. So that is called Sopadhika Ishwara, Nirupadhika Ishwara. Sopadhika Ishwara means Sa Upadhi. With Upadhi of Maya, this Bhagwan is there in this Virat Roop, Hiranyagarbha and Ishwara. Surrender the ego to any of these and ultimately one will come to realize I am Brahman only. So there is no question of feeling inferior or superior. Oh, these are wise people, they don't accept any form. I am lower than them, so I am inferior. No, Brahman, we both are Brahman. Depending on whatever samskaras are there, Bhamar Sadhana, Chitta Shuddhi, etc., one can choose. Take an Ishta Devata or take Virat Roop or take Hiranyagarbha or Ishwara, contemplate on Brahman, whichever one likes. And you see, this one line has come in between, just quietly it is, and no elaboration is given. Quietly it is just put inside here, that's it. Again the Srishti starts. So till now he gave the description. Now somebody says, "Acha, but I thought, Brahmaji was the one who created, just earlier we saw that. He was, created from the navel of Mahavishnu and then he was sitting and then he was wondering what to do and then he did tapasya and then all that we heard and then he created. Now suddenly here it is said now this Mahanarayana, this Vishnu Bhagavan created this whole thing. Narayana created this. So this cosmic being from whom came Nara, who is Nara and then who became Narayana and then who created all this. So you finally tell me who created, Brahma created or Narayan created? You are confusing me a lot. Bhagavatam says very clearly, Sa Vachya Vachakataya Bhagavan Brahma Rupa Dhrik Nama Rupa Kriya Dhatte Sakarma Karmaka Paraha. That Narayana only became Brahma. See, the Supreme Lord by itself doesn't do anything. That is Brahman. But we can't accept that. So then we say, okay, using his power of Maya, he became active. So actionless Brahman, who is Nirupadhika, absolute truth, now became the Karta as the Ishwara, the cosmic intelligence, and assumed the form of Brahma. He reveals himself, assuming the form of Brahma, he reveals himself both in the form of the word and what it denotes, and evolves many a name and form and activity. So it is he only who became Brahma. Acha, they are one and the same. Yes, they are one and the same. So don't get confused. Who created? Brahma created or Narayan created? See, in that earlier analogy also, na, Nara, Mahan, Narayana is, Mahavishnu is sleeping on the, what is that? Serpent, bed of serpents, Adishesha, and then from his navel, this flower, lotus comes, and then Bhagwan Brahmaji is sitting on that. He is creating. What is the symbolism there? That Supreme Lord doesn't have the sense of agency. Karta Bhava is not there because creation only is not there. Srishti also is not there. Then when Brahmaji comes and Brahmaji becomes the creator. So the sense of agency comes only when this Maya is invoked and then one cosmic Upadhi is created out of it, which is called as Brahmaji in that case. Same thing he is saying here. That absolute is actionless only, but then using the power of Maya, then he only becomes Brahmaji. And then he created the world. So that's where it is. Now, till this point of 35, that is called Sarga. Now from this 36 onwards is called Visarga. So the second topic which we saw in the 10 topics, Visarga, is what Brahmaji creates and then the Jivas create, etc. That is all called Visarga. So that was the definition of Visarga, what was given there. Visarga Paurusha Smritaha. So that is this. Now Visarga comes. When basic things have been created, then using all those, how did the Srishti happen? So now Brahmaji, he has to create. So all this, Prajapati, Manu, Rishis, then all the Pitrus, and the Siddhas, Charanas, Gandharvas, Vidyadharas, Asuras, Yakshas, Kinnaras, Apsaras, Naga, Serpents, Kim Purusha, they are demigods, snakes, Matrikas, Rakshasas, Pishacha, Preta, Bhuta, Vinayakas, Pushmandas, Unmadas, Vetalas, then Yatudhanas and Grahas, birds, reptiles, beasts, prey, and other animals, trees, mountains, all other names and forms in the universe are his. Meaning Brahmaji created all this and they all are appearances of that one supreme reality only. And in this Bhagavatam also comes this description that there are, in our spiritual literature, we see four types of beings, meaning four types of births of the beings. Svedaja, Andaja, Udbhijja and Jarayuja. Four types. Beings are born through any of these four. So the animate and inanimate and viviparous, oviparous, sweat born or sprouting from soil. These are the four. Svedaja, born out of sweat. Andaja, born out of egg. So all this chicken and all that, so many birds and all, born out of egg. And then Udbhijja, plants and trees and all, born out of soil. And then Jarayuja, born from the womb. So all the mammals and humans and all of those are. See that now, if you see Bhagavatam is so old, at that time also they knew all these life forms are born from various four types of births. And then living either in water or land or in the air, they are the good, bad and mixed fruit of corresponding actions. Now, all these different types of creations which are there, they are how? They are created how? So we say, yes, one is the Ishwar Srishti. So with Prakriti, the beings, they evolve on their own. And then from human birth onwards, the evolution is in their hands. So it is said, when there is predominance of Sattva, Rajas and Tamas, is severally responsible for the birth as a god, human being and denizens of hell. So predominance of Sattva will bring Devata Yoni, then Rajas will bring Manusha Yoni and Tamas will bring Asura Yoni, or as a member of the subhuman species. Each of these three gunas is again divided into three varieties according to each of the three gunas is eclipsed by either of the other two gunas or not. Which means what? See, three gunas, predominance of each guna gives a particular yoni. Devata, Manushya, Asura. In these three also, there are Sattvic Devata, Rajasic Devata, Tamasic Devata. Sattvic man, Rajasic man, Tamasic man. Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic, Asura. Achha, if there's a Sattvic Asura, then why did that person become Asura? Some karma must have been done, to exhaust that is born in Asura Yoni. So that karma phala is, to exhaust that karma phala is when the jiva is born. But the mind of the jiva can be sattvic. That is unique. Like Vibhishan is born in the Asura Kula. Some karma he must have done in the past that the physical body's birth is in the Asura Kula. But the mind is sattvic. You see, that is why I am saying that this human body is very rare. Better get Jivan Mukti, because even after doing so much sadhana, suddenly we go land up in Asura Kula then. Because some karma, if that body is deserved and you know, whichever karma is ready according to that, one will get a body. And that's how one sees all these varieties in the animals also. Like Jada Bharat, he became a deer. Mind is very sattvic, but he became deer because he got attached to that fawn. See, so that's the reason why in the predominance of sattva, rajas, tamas may give a particular birth. But please remember, this particular birth is a result of the karma phala. So at that time, the jiva need not be tamasic to get a tamasic body. At that time, the jiva can be sattvic, but the karma phala done in tamas earlier sometime, that deserves the body of a rakshasa or a devata. So in devalok also we find or not. Some devata are very sattvic devatas. Some devatas like Indra, very rajasic, very insecure. Some little tapasya somebody does, he will get insecure. And then tamasic devatas who just eat, drink, be merry and drink and fall somewhere. That's all. The tamasic also. But then how did he land up there? Some good karma he did and some punya he acquired and he had desire to go to heaven. Just because somebody did sakama karma does not and got punya does not mean tamas does not exist in that person. Tamas exists. But that punya phala, to exhaust that punya phala, he went to heaven. Because he desired heaven, so he did that sakama karma and got the punya. So that's the combination. So three gunas create predominantly these three, but in that also there's combination of sattva, rajas and tamas possible. Now you can do your mathematics. How many janmas, how many yonis, what all one can do. Better to get jivan mukti is one human yoni where we can get. So all this is meant for that. It's not meant for figuring out does all this really exist. Nothing exists. It's all time pass. To make us aware that all this is not there, you are Brahman, full stop. None of this exists otherwise. Which is what it will come to now. You watch that beautiful point. This chapter, these are two main things to learn. Apart from these other 10 aspects of Mahapurana and all that, one what was already said, you know, the wise people don't accept these forms because they are created by Maya, they are not reality. They are the wise people, really wise people who say nothing doing. Brahman alone exists, rope alone exists. Where is the snake? We don't accept snake only. So now what he says here, having assumed the form of Vishnu for support of sustenance of the world, the same Lord preserves and sustains the universe by appearing from time to time in the guise of animals, men and gods. That he says in the 42nd one. Saeva idam jagaddhata bhagavan dharma rupadruk pushnati sthapayan vishvam tiryam narasuratmabhi. So that cosmic being only became Brahma. He only became now Vishnu also as the sustainer of the universe. Remember, every creation as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesha, every creation. And there are multiples of creation like that. That cosmic being has become Brahma, Vishnu and Rudra for every creation. And to sustain Dharma, that Vishnu will take birth also. Now don't get again confused saying, "Acha, it is a chota Vishnu which takes birth as avatar. Then what about that Mahavishnu? Are that Mahavishnu only is this Vishnu?" That's what he's saying here. He only became that. So don't get confused with that. The same Vishnu only. Mahanarayana, Mahavishnu, or this Vishnu, whatever you say, it's all one and the same. Then what happens? Then who is the Rudra? So again, when the time comes, the Lord appears as Rudra from the fire of universal destruction and dissolves the whole universe once created by himself, even as a blast blows away a mass of clouds. What an analogy. One blast blows away, full cloud is gone just by the breeze. Full creation gone, effortlessly, just like that. Rudra. Yesterday we did Rudra Abhishek. In that, one meaning of Rudra is that one who makes people cry. Who cries? When they are attached, they will cry. Those jivas who are attached to the samsara, to the world of people, things, beings, objects, all that, they will cry, "Hare, I am going to die. Hare, this world is going to end." Devotee doesn't cry, because where are you going? Bhagavan only, our source. Na? We are going back to Bhagavan. From Bhagavan, we came back to Bhagavan. What is there to cry? No. But you know, all these people and all that, they all came from Bhagavan only. So all of us will go back to Bhagavan. So Brahma, Vishnu and Rudra, all are appearances of one cosmic being. And then the creation process is given. Now you see what he says. Ittham bhavena kathito Bhagavan bhagavattamaha netham bhavena hi param drashtumarhanti surayaha. He says, the Lord who is possessed of inconceivable power has been described as above, as a creator, preserver and destroyer. The wise, however, should not regard him only as such, for he is even beyond his description. Which is why we are seeing this portion, that cosmic being is beyond even that Ishvara Tattva. Is that Supreme Brahman using the Maya only became that cosmic being, then the whole Ishvara, Avyakta and Mahat and everything came. That Supreme Being meaning Brahman here. One should not think that this Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh is the ultimate. No, it is the Supreme. And why he is saying this first 44th line is because of 45. Nasya karmani janmadav parasyanubhidhiyate kartritva pratishedhartham Maya yaropitam hitat ayam tu brahmana kalpaha. So 45. Now you see, this is the important line. The Supreme has no doership in relation to creation and other activities connected with this universe. The Shruti texts ascribe it to him only with a view to denying it, for the same has been superimposed on him by Maya. There is no kartritva bhav in the absolute. Brahman is non-dual absolute reality. Brahman alone exists. Nothing else exists. But if we see creation, then we say, from where it came? From Brahman it came. How it came? Brahman cannot create. Then who created? Brahman plus Maya. That Maya Shakti gives the upadhi of Ishvara and he became the creator. But at the same time, he is the non-dual non-dual bliss absolute Brahman also. So these are two standpoints. One is the transcendental standpoint, where there is no creation, which in Vedanta and Upanishad we call as Ajatavada, no creation at all. Which same Bhakti is also saying, there is no creation, there is no doership. in that Supreme. Then why all this? That is because we are seeing the creation, we are asking from where it came. So if we say from where it came, there cannot be any other source except Brahman. But Brahman cannot produce. So then how did creation happen? So we say, okay, Maya, and the play of this Maya. So Maya is the creator. Brahman is Akarta still. And that's why he says this whole process of creation is to deny the negate, is to deny the doership in the absolute, which means none of us got created. Why? Because there cannot be any other karta. If at all the snake came, first of all, snake never came, rope alone is. Now, if at all one says, no, snake is there, then from where it came? Oh, from rope it came. The dream world does not exist in reality. Waker is lying on the bed, full stop. That's a better example. Rope and snake can confuse a little. Dream example is the best. Dream world does not exist. Waker is lying on the bed. Now, but if somebody says, no, dream is real, then from where it came? Waker's mind it came. That Waker's mind it came is a false superimposition to explain to us, okay, this is the process, so that we think about the Waker. The more we think about the Waker, then we realize, okay, I am that Brahman. Our ego surrenders. Then we realize that none of this existed. So this second chapter of Bhagavatam is sadhana pradhan. The first one was adhikari skanda, this is sadhana skanda. This is the culmination of all sadhanas, is what? To realize I am that Brahman who is non-dual, who has no doership, who has no creation, nothing in it. And that's why he says the all this they explain and ascribe doership only to deny it, because there is no sense of there is no doership in that Supreme Brahman. So this is the conclusion of all sadhana. The culmination of all sadhana is in this. Now sarga is over, visarga is over. Now what they say is the difference between sarga and visarga. So now you see, ayam tu brahmana kalpaha savikalpa udharutaha vidhi sadharano yatra sarga prakrita vaikritaha parimanam cha kalasya kalpa kalpa lakshana vigraham yatha purastad vyakhyasye padmam kalpa matho shunu. So now he says here that I have told you the great about the great kalpa connected with the appearance of Brahma, and also about the other smaller kalpas. The process of creation is the same in all the kalpas. The only difference being that during a mahakalpa, so mahakalpa means the kalpa immediately following a mahapralay or final dissolution, the whole process of creation begins anew. So including even the transformation of matter from the evolution of mahat down to crystallization of the five elements. While in the other kalpas, the kalpas following a night of Brahma, it is only the bodies of the animate and inanimate that are created anew. I shall describe in full the measure of time, the duration of a kalpa and its division later on in chapter 3. Now hear the story of Padma Kalpa. Now before he can explain this Padma Kalpa, this Shaunakji has put some question in between. So this Padmakalpa description comes later. It gets postponed. Now this, suddenly this question in between has got to be answered now. Now what does this section mean here? See, Sarga means Brahmaji's life, because Brahmaji also is created by Ishwara, no? Supreme Lord. That Supreme Lord created Brahmaji. That is, which we saw, no? That five elements and basic material is created by the Supreme. So that is called Sarga. So Brahmaji life is 100 years. So the entire creation is completely new at the time of Sarga. So that's what he said here. The process of creation is same, only difference being that in Mahakalpa, the whole process of creation begins anew, including all this transformation of matter, evolution of Mahat to five elements. Everything is new, absolutely new in Mahakalpa. When Mahapralaya happens, after Brahmaji, his tenure is over, and next Brahmaji has to come. That is called Mahakalpa. So that creation at that time is called Sarga, because Brahmaji is created by Supreme Being. Then Brahmaji is every day, one day is that many, you know, what is that? Mahayuga. Satyug, Tretayug, Dwaparyug, Kaliyug. One day of Brahmaji. Again, Pralaya will happen. That is one night of Brahmaji, which is again same tenure of Satyug, Tretayug, Dwaparyug, Kaliyug. Brahmaji sleeps. Like this, it will go on. 360 days is 1 year, like this, 100 years. So again and again, those kalpas which keep coming up because of each day of Brahmaji, that is called Visarga. In that, what happens? Raw material, etc. remains same. That is not recreated. Then who? Only the bodies of the jivas and the inanimate things are created new. Because according to the karma, jiva will get new bodies. Because pralaya has happened, again the jiva has to take birth. So according to the karma, they will get new bodies. So this completes the sarga and visarga part of the 10 topics of Bhagavatam. Now, because the topic of kalpa and mahakalpa, etc. was raised, so here he says, you know, Shukdevji says that I will explain to you in the story of this Padma Kalpa. But before he goes to do that, this Shaunak Rishi, he is asking Sutaji something in between. So that is little confusing, because from where did he pick this up? He picked this up from the earlier chapter. See, sometimes it happens when doubt is lurking in the mind and suddenly the topic is something going on, and you know, the very intelligently these people will ask, this is unrelated to the topic, but you know, I want to ask this question. It is like that. Something else was going on in the class, unrelated completely, suddenly something in between will come. It is not a new phenomenon. That has been happening for ages together. So that is what now suddenly he says. So Shaunakji is asking Sutaji now. Yadahano bhavan suta kshatta bhagavatottamaha chachara tirthani bhuvastya chachara tirthani bhuvastyaktva bandhun sadustyajan. So Sutaji is saying, you told us how Vidur, who was the foremost of the lost devotees, left his kith and kin at the time of Mahabharat war, and he went to Tirtha Yatra. And there he had met Maitreya Rishi and he had asked some questions. So he says, what did he ask and what did his great Maitreya Rishi explain? You please tell us that story. Now Shukdevji is telling some things to Parikshit, which is being narrated by Sutaji to Shaunak Rishi. Now when this one portion of Shukdevji telling to Parikshit Raja is completed, Sarga and Visarga, then logically you would have gone to the next portion. But suddenly now this Shaunakji is asking Sutaji, wait, this Vidur went now after Mahabharat, when Mahabharat war was about to begin, Vidur went away for Tirtha Yatra and then he met Rishi. So with the Maitreya Rishi he met. What did that Maitreya Rishi say? So now that's where Sutaji says that interesting is the Parikshit Raja also asked the same question. Is King Parikshit to ask this very question? Rajna Parikshito Parikshita Prashto यदोवाचन महामुनि तद्व्योभिधास्ये शृणुतु शृणुत राज्ञा प्रश्नानुसारतः. He says, Parikshit Raja also asked the same question, so I will tell you the discourse that happened between Shukadeva and Parikshit Raja. That is just a connection to say ki I am not telling this by myself. Shukadeva ji had asked this. And please remember sequence, don't try to put a sequence here. Did Parikshit ask in the same sequence that after this immediately? Parikshit Raja may have asked any time to Shukadeva ji. Shukadeva ji must have replied. This Sut ji remembers that, so he is quoting that here. That's all. That is my simple understanding. Because we remember this Mahapurana and this Purana especially, which includes Mahapurana also, that both this Purana and Mahapurana, they don't follow chronology. It is not itihasa. We saw last time that the sequential chronological thing is not the style of the Purana or the Mahapurana. It will go by shiksha, by knowledge. It is knowledge pradhan. So that concludes our chapter 2, Sadhana Skandha. Chapter 3 we will take up in our next class. Shruti ji, you have a question. Yes.
Yeah, Hari Om Swami ji. I don't know, my Wi-Fi dropped for a bit. So I hope I'm not repeating something you've already said. When we say that from Narayan Bhagwan, because you know, to explain the non-doership from Narayan Bhagwan's nabhi,
yeah,
Amaji came out. Even that actually is not a possibility because therein itself is a change. So dekha jaye to that is also not possible only when we are looking at him as the non-doer.
When we look at him as a non-doer, so definitely Narayan Bhagwan himself is not a possibility. In that sense. Okay.
But in that sense, I was looking at more. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. Continue.
Yeah. So then one is that way. So if you say as from imagery standpoint, Narayan Bhagwan is real, then the non-doership is still maintained because it is not by his will that it happened. The other things happened by his will. It is not that Narayan Bhagwan is thinking, now I will create Brahmaji. Then doership comes, will comes. No? He says it happened. Now that is what is difficult to explain.
Okay.
Because how it happened, matlab kya? One will say that, you know, how can it happen without the will? But the fact is, we are considering that as real, so we are thinking will has to be there, doership has to be there. Now, that's the fundamental point Vedanta is trying to say. So at some point, we will have to explain saying ki nahi, wo ho gaya. Ab kaise hua? Are jo hua hi nahi, to uska kaise hua, kahan pooch rahe? But who is ready to understand ki it never happened? So then, one will say, okay, from the Nabhi, this Brahmaji came, because the people are more interested in the Srishti Kram. They are not interested in the non-doership of Narayana. So even if Brahmaji is coming, none of the verses of Bhagavatam said that Narayana willed and then Brahmaji came out. He was lying and then Brahmaji manifested, appeared. Oh, yeah.
So the non-willing, so if I may use that language, is again to depict his non-doership. Because the moment he wills something, there is some kind of an agitation.
Yeah.
And there is then there is some movement. Movement means there is doership, there is some action.
Yeah. So what happens is the analogy is used depending on the adhikari bheda. Uttam Adhikari is there, then they will say that it just happened, there is no doership there. Actually, for absolutely Uttam Adhikari, they will say creation only is not there. But suppose we say one level lower, then we say that Narayana is there, without doership, Brahmaji just manifested. But if somebody is not able to understand even that, then we say that, Bhagavan Narayana, he wanted to, like they say in this, that he was alone, then he wanted to become many, so he invoked the power of Maya, and then he So then you say that one thought agitation came and then Brahmaji was created and then Srishti happened. Either of these explanations, that he invoked Maya to become many or he created Brahmaji and became many. Both these are for the level where one wants explanation for creation.
Exactly, because even for Brahmaji to be created, it can't be without Maya. Like you said, even Narayan Bhagwan actually from that becomes Upadhik.
Yeah.
Because if we are looking at Narayan Bhagwan, not as Brahman and but as Narayan Bhagwan, as Mahavishnu also, then that is again, he's already become Upadhik.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Or no?
Yeah, yes. That it becomes Upadhik only. Absolute Brahman cannot have any name, form, attributes, action, nothing. So, from that standpoint, to explain in Bhakti Marg is very difficult. So in Bhakti Marg, keeping the form as Narayana or the Mahavishnu, depicting Brahman, no doership will be ascribed to him. Because that some devotee who wants the ultimate as a form or as a something concept to grasp, for them they will say that Narayana is non-doer. Mahavishnu Narayana is non-doer. Then Brahmaji just came.
So then Swamiji, very weird. Okay, but then from this, a very weird question just cropped up in the mind was, what happens? So this, is this a belief that only Vaishnavs, this thing, that only the Bhagavad Puran says, or this theory of creation is across all the Puranas, whether it is Shiv Puran or Devi Puran or all of them? The recognition of Narayan Bhagwan, or there also there are kind of debates and fights, so to speak.
No. Each Purana, that particular deity will be the supreme, no? So in Shiva Puran, Shiva will be the absolute. And then he will use his...
So there will be some story to describe.
Right now I am doing that Shiva name. So if we are reading those things, so Usme, then Shivji only has blessed Brahma, Shivji has blessed Vishnu, Shivji has blessed... Rudra, all these happen. Shivji is the ultimate reality, and then he alone exists, and that is Shiva Tattva. And then the creation happens with when Parvati comes forward. It's Vamadeva, the name Vamadeva. Vama means on whose left is Parvati. So then Shiva and Shakti together get the whole creation. So in every Purana, the basic concept remains the same, the deity changes. The ultimate deity, ultimate depiction of the deity, that's all is different. Otherwise, it is same. The Shiva Tattva has no doership. Shiva Tattva is absolute. Shiva Tattva is beyond time, space, causation. Same it is here is Narayana, Mahavishnu. Somewhere else it will be Devi. Somewhere else it will be Ganesh. Because that's how Ganesh is worshipped by Shivji when he is getting married. Otherwise, how strange is that? How can the father marry, worship the son before marriage? And this is not a modern type of a thing. A child is existing before marriage. Aisa thodi. So it is that way.
Okay. Achha, Swamiji, one more thing in this was that you said that in every in every creation, the Trinity also goes on changing. Devas go on changing because they are jivas based on their karmas. I mean, that part I get. But why? There's no need, because it is his power only that is coming out as the creative sustenance and destruction. It is Ishwara's power only that comes out as all three. So then why do we say that Brahmaji also goes on changing? Because the power remains the same, no?
See, power in all of us is the same, okay? Power in jiva is also same. Power in the Brahmaji, Vishnu, Mahesh also is the same, but these are positions. So we say that the next kalpa...
But it's not held by a deva, no?
No, wait.
But the position is not held by a deva,
no? I'm coming to that. So this initial Brahmaji, if we say initial, when the Mahakalpa is over, whatever. When the first kalpa started, which again is an assumption, but okay, it started. That time Brahmaji is created by Narayana Bhagavan. After that Brahmaji, after that Narayana Bhagavan doesn't keep creating Brahmaji. What they say, this kalpas Hanumanji is next kalpas Brahmaji. So it is a jiva taking that position.
Oh, so only the, so to speak, original Brahmaji is the Ishwara's power, to so to speak. And all the other Brahmajis are positions that the higher Devatas are taking.
Not higher
Devatas. Jivas are taking.
The Jivas,
Jivas become Devatas, Devatas becoming, no?
Yeah, but Hanumanji is not a Devata. Hanumanji is Hanumanji. He becomes that, because then the capabilities of that Jiva will be equal to this Brahma only. So the capabilities won't change. The position, when they come to that position, they will have all the same powers as the earlier Brahma.
Okay.
So this Hanumanji will become next Brahma. Like that they will have, one big list is given. Of which culture?
I thought this coming out from the Nabhi and this mantra happening in every Mahakalpa. It's not happening apparently
in every Mahakalpa. That's why he says here, Kalpa, only the Kalpa may, it doesn't happen, because Kalpa is when Brahmaji goes to sleep, again he gets up. And Mahakalpa, then the creation starts completely new, where everything is dissolved.
So in Mahakalpa will happen again, no?
So that's what I'm saying. That's the first time only, na, Brahmaji got created. First time when Brahmaji gets created, then that Brahmaji will be there for 100 years. Then the Mahapralaya will happen. Now if we say ki again Brahmaji will come from Nabhi of Mahavishnu only,
no.
That need not be the case. It is possible that one Hanumanji becomes that. Because Jivas have got created, no?
Swamiji, I think better to, than trying to understand creation or Ishwara's mind, it is better to just realize the truth.
It is definitely better. It will go like this, round, round only, because different things will say different things. Different Puranas will say different things. So we, so for some we may get some answers, for some we may not even get. Ye kaise ho raha hai? Again we have to read some more Puranas to figure out, achha, how did Brahmaji now become this? Because at the end of Mahapralaya, all the Jivas go back. All the worlds also go back. And they say that everything gets created new. Then how Brahmaji became, how Hanumanji became the next Brahma? So there will be something in between. We have to check that. You know, this Srishti Kram in terms of time, I am not very clear about that. That how many kalpas make one, whatever, Mahayuga, and then how many such Mahayugas, and then what is a Manvantara, some 71 things happen. There's one Srishti Kram which is there. I will check that and I will come back. But from whatever I understood till now, I am thinking that Brahmaji is first created by, the rest of it keeps taking off, keeps taking. The Jivas keep taking the positions.
I think as a sadhak, I guess if I'm reading this.
I will try.
I think but I think beyond the point, Swamiji, if I make it too academic, the point is that if I'm reading about Supadhik or Nirupadhik, does it invoke bhakti in me, wonder? That this is also something so impossible seems possible. I think that is the point, because beyond the point, if one starts chasing, it's like a tunnel which is unending, and yeah, this very precious human life is getting caught in that without having invoked bhakti. So, but it is just that little bit of a doubt was there, so I just needed to check that.
We'll try and solve it. Mila answer to theek hai.
Yeah. Theek hai. Okay, Swamiji. Thank you.
Vibhaji.
Yeah, Swamiji. Yeah. What are is Bhuvarlok Pitralok? What when we say Bhur Bhuvasva?
No. Bhuvarlok is not equal to Pitralok.
Okay. What is Pitralok? And what are Pitrus?
Pitrus are the ancestors from whom we have been born, who have left their bodies and who are waiting in a Pitralok. which is near Surya Lok somewhere. Beyond this, Aditya Lok is called Pitru Lok.
Okay.
So Bhuvar Lok is the in between. The transition loka is called Bhuvar Lok. Now, based on the karma from the Bhuvar Lok, the jiva will go through Pitru Lok to heaven or hell, based on whatever the karma phala is the karma phala experience. And also based on this Uttarayan, Dakshinayan, all that.
So when the cosmic being created, the Pitrus, means they are coming from the earlier kalpas. Those Pitrus are coming from earlier kalpas. The cosmic being. Now we just read.
Yeah, so now that depends on the standpoint that we are taking. If we say this is the first creation, which is what is Sarga, then there is no earlier kalpa. Then all beings are created by Bhagwan from his Maya Shakti only.
So then where did the Pitrus come from in the first creation?
That's why I'm saying this. Just like the from where the birds, animals and all came, from there Pitrus also came, which is Bhagwan
okay.
only.
Okay.
So one, so they don't have to be necessarily only you know, after the death of the human body, they become Pitrus. That is not the only criteria. No, just like human beings are created, plants, birds, animals are created, devatas are created, because it is not that only after the human being does the punya karma, then devata is created. No, devata is a separate category existing on its own, right?
Okay.
Then human beings can become that.
Okay.
With their purushat. Like that, Pitrus is one category. Yaksha is one category. Gandharva is one category. It's like a species. Okay. 84 lakh species when we say. Okay. Pitru is also one. We may say, no, 84 lakh species is on the earth. Then if we say it is on the earth, then it is not a part of that 84 lakh species, but it's a part of the overall srishti. Mein how many of our species are there? It's one part of that.
Okay.
Yeah. But otherwise, Pitrus, if you say, then jiva, human being, when the body is dropped through Bhuvar Loka, goes to Pitru Loka, and then accordingly, according to karma, goes up and down.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Swami.
Yeah, Hari Om, Swamiji. Yeah. Swamiji, I wanted to ask you that this entire Sarga section is basically from the Jeeva standpoint?
No, Ishwar standpoint.
Ishwar, yeah, but Ishwar exists because there is a Jeeva, right?
No, no. How Ishwar exists because there is Jeeva?
Because there is identification with the body, and therefore you will believe that, I mean, till then there is Ishwar. But the moment you realize the absolute, there is no Ishwar either.
No. See, we are mixing up two points here. Ram. Point one is, what is being described here is the Srishti Kram. In the Srishti Kram, the totality comes first. Then the individuality comes. So this Srishti Kram, the sequence of creation, is from the subtle standpoint to the gross standpoint. And Jiva is the gross. So that you saw, na, the whole Srishti, how did it happen? Brahmaji created all the beings after the cosmic being, no? So cosmic being is first. Then comes the gross beings, which is the bodies of all these human beings and Gandharva, Yaksha, all these. This is one standpoint, which is from Srishti Kram standpoint. Then what you are saying is from after the Srishti has been created, when we are doing sadhana, if that jiva negates that there is no Ishvara, to explain to that jiva, we say, no, no, if you are real, God is real.
Yes.
So this
that's what I'm saying.
Level. So these are two different levels. So from that standpoint of jiva, then we say that yes, the if I exist, then God also exists. If I have a form, God also has form. If I am formless, God is formless. But God is the totality, I am a part of that. No, so part without whole. God is not a of all small parts. So that is what. So now these are the two different standpoints.
Because Swamiji, when you come to Visarga in the again in the 45th verse, everything is negated, right? There is no doership. So the Visarga is anyways the Sarga is negated by the Visarga. So was the
Sarga is negated by Visarga from the sadhana standpoint.
So once you do the sadhana, you realize the absolute, then there is no Sarga. So was the Sarga theory explained so that it could be negated later?
That's what the Upanishad said. That's what they said earlier, that these wise people don't accept this because it is all Maya. It is not real. And it was also said, it is only to deny it. Verse also said that it is only to deny the doership is all this explanation is given. So Sarga is actually given to explain to us the what is beyond creation and to negate creation.
To negate it, right.
That the jiva has to do through their sadhana, shravan, manan, nididhyasana.
Right. So once you attain the truth yourself, then Sarga is completely negated, right? That is no, not from my standpoint, from the standpoint of the Jivan Mukta.
Yeah, it is not negated. Actually, what it happened is we can say at one level negated, but what happens is that that person realizes that entity, or actually there's no entity, the oneness is. What does the waker realize? That there was never a dream.
No dream. Wow.
Example of dream has a limitation because dream was still experienced, but the jiva experiences there never was, is, will be any creation. Not even an illusion, or that I was there as a jiva for some time, because in dream example, that's a limitation there. That I was a jiva there for some time, who was in the dream state and then who woke up. So there is some relative reality given to that dream character. In this, there is no such relative reality. The snake never was, is, will be, full stop, rope alone is. That's the realization. So negation of the creation is one level higher than accepting creation as illusion or real, but higher than negation of creation is that there never got
any. Never was a creation. Yeah. That its existence was not there only. Yeah. Okay, so thank you, Hari Om.
Swamiji, Hari Om. Swamiji, out of curiosity, I just want to know, we were talking about Pitralok right now. So we are from the lineage of certain rishis, right? So when we say Pitralok, will our these rishis will be there in the Pitralok? And my second question is that, don't they take a body subsequently? So who is there in the Pitralok then?
Who takes the body?
Means, suppose the rishis have passed on, right? So don't they come back to the form again? Why will they be in the Pitralok? Or for that matter, our ancestors?
See, first and foremost, the Saptarishis are not in Pitralok. The Saptarishis are there as long as the Kalpa of the creation exists. And hence, in every Kalpa, the Saptarishi Mandal changes. So the Saptarishis stay in a separate realm called Saptarishi Mandal.
Okay.
That's what you see in the star, no? Seven stars.
Yeah.
Saptarishi Mandal, they live separately. Not in Pitralok, number one. So that answers the first part. You don't go back to the Rishi, but the Rishi's guidance is available to that jivas of that Kula wherever they are. If jivas are open and the jivas do those type of actions, or they remember the guidance is available. Then comes the aspect of, if Pitras take form, then who is there in Pitralok? Are Pitralok is one common lok. Innumerable amount of jivas are there. It's like saying, if bahut sare log mar jayenge yahan pe, to earth pe kaun rahega? Aisa nahi hota hai. The cycle of creation is such that there is continuously death happening, transition happening, going into Pitralok, reborn, again new people coming in. It's a loop. It's a loop. Continuously this keeps going on. So Pitralok will be there. And worst come worst, if we say that chalo Pitralok khali ho gaya, to bhi kya farak padta hai? Aisa thodi hai ki har log bhara hua hai rehna chahiye. When the jiva is ready, the jiva will go there. Transit lounge need not be always filled with people. Sometimes the transit lounge is empty. So empty. So it's like that.
Okay, thank you, sir.
There will be pitrus of our other births. Possible.
Yeah, we don't have only Pitrus. When we count Pitrus, we're thinking of Pitrus only of this particular. Me and Shruti Somani having God knows how many Pitrus. But me and Shruti Somani must have lived a million other lives, will have had a million zillion other ancestors. So there'll be so many Pitrus who I owe and have debts too.
All the possibilities are there.
No shortage of Pitrus.
Nothing. I told you, na, this chapter is like this. Jo mukhya tattva hai na, वो छोड़ के बाकी सब चीज में हमको बहुत आनंद आता है. ये क्या होगा, इसका क्या होगा, वैसा क्या होगा. आई एम नॉट सेइंग एनीथिंग रॉन्ग इन आस्किंग एनी सच क्वेश्चंस, बट आवर माइंड, यू सी, ऑब्जर्वेशन ऑफ आवर माइंड इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. हिज माइंड इज रियली इंटरेस्टेड टू फाइंड मोर अबाउट क्रिएशन देन इन द ब्रह्मन हु इज बियॉन्ड क्रिएशन वेयर नो क्रिएशन एग्जिस्ट, बिकॉज दैट लुक्स लिटिल बोरिंग टू अस. Absolute bliss, no creation, no duality. Sometimes it is not that attractive as creation and the levels and then the so many worlds and then kalpa and mahakalpa and then, you know, you can travel from one what is that, universe to another universe, and one Brahmaji Vishnu Mahesh of one universe interact with one Brahmaji Vishnu Mahesh of other universe. Just think of the possibilities, how much the mind can keep thinking about all these things. Definitely is better than thinking about worldly stuff. At least in this, the mind is expanding and thinking of, oh, this possibility. So that is no doubt very good. And in that sense, Bhagavatam and other Puranas are, you know, they are very helpful to make our mind subtler, because now we are thinking of so many possibilities. So the Vishay Chintan gets replaced. So in that sense, it is very good. But from the realization standpoint, it can also be quite tempting. And it can distract us from realization also. Because one may say, abhi mujhe ye lok mein jana hai. I want to cross this 14 and see in another one, which whether it is same as this or not. Because there is no control over desire now. When we know something, then we want to experience. Then the desire will start. And we may say, no, Swamiji, logical mind of ours doesn't think like that. We will remain focused on Brahman, which is a great thing. Definitely we can. But when which desire arises, we have no idea. Suddenly one may desire, kiya, I want to experience this type of a species. I've never heard. Who are these Kim Purushas? Some one life I should become a Kim Purusha. Mind is like that, very fickle. So holding on to feet of Bhagwan, anything else we do, Chintan, there is no problem. But feet of the Lord or contemplation of Brahman, that one should hold on to. The rest of it will go. By time, by grace, it will all go. Okay, let's do the Aarti. Are, we completed chapter 2. We have to read first shloka of chapter 2. Because every chapter we finish, we have to read the first shloka. Shri Shuka Uvacha Vari Yaneshate Prashnaha Kruto Loka Hito Nripa Atma Vitsammata Pumsam Shrotavyadishu Yaparaha Kayena Vacha Manasendriya Irva Buddhya Atmanava Prakrite Svabhavat करोमि अद्यत् सकलं परस्मै नारायणायेति समर्पयामि नारायणायेति समर्पयामि.